As everybody, I should start thanking the organizers and the audience for coming. And so many people, or in particular Jonathan and Andy Wand and other people, have introduced some of the words I will be using. So I'm aware that not everybody goes to every talk, so I will be using these words freely, so just don't hesitate to ask. So I want to discuss one theorem or two theorems, and so because I don't have to go through these preliminaries, I thought I would change kind of a little the way that I the talk from the way I usually give it or kind of present this result. So it will be more examples, and I will discuss some C0 things. So the starting point of this story is a theorem of Eliasberg and Thurston, which was on the board already, but so what does it say? So you start with a foliation on a 3-manifold, which is closed, oriented. So I will assume that the foliation is C2 for now. Foliation is closed, oriented. And I assume one thing. And the foliation is not diffeomorphic to a foliation by spheres on this S2 cross S1. So so then every C0 neighborhood of TF contains a positive contact structure. And it contains a negative one, so if you change this orientation. Okay, so maybe one comment. So Jonathan and Cazes and Roberts have proved an analog of this theorem with a zero here. So the kind of the statements differ at some point, and we just keep it as it is. So I won't need the C0 version for now. But there are C0 versions, and both are sufficient for whatever I'm going to say about C0 foliations. Okay, so this is one theorem. And the other theorem is, so why is this theorem interesting? So if you have a construction of an interesting foliation, you get a potentially interesting contact structure. So now, the question I asked myself some time ago was kind of how, to what extent does the foliation determine the contact structure that kind of are in very small neighborhoods of it? So the answer in the context of C2 at least is as follows. I don't know, 14 maybe or 13. So F is as above, or F is a C2 foliation on M3, which is still closed. And so such that there are no torus leaves. Not every leaf is a plane. And not every leaf is a cylinder. So foliations such that there are cylindrical leaves and planar leaves and nothing else are perfectly fine. Okay, so mixed cases are fine. So, okay. So then there is a C0 neighborhood of TF such that all positive contact structures in that neighborhood are, I don't know, pairwise isotopic. Okay, so what I wanted to do first, of course, I have to discuss these assumptions. So no torus leaves should be clear. So torus leaves are common, a common problem. So not every leaf is a plane. So in the C2 category, and actually also in the C0 category, the only manifolds admitting a foliation by planes is the three torus. So you should think of this kind of as a rare thing. So this, what I just said in the C2 world, is a result by Rosenberg. And there's a similar result by Hector for this cylindrical case. So in this case, what you get is you get parabolic T2 bundles over S1. So these are some T2 bundles over S1, and they're pretty special. So this is the essential restriction. And so, OK, fine. So this theorem has applications, and Jonathan already mentioned these. So this was actually, the motivation was to kind of show that taut foliations, which are homotopic through foliations, may not be homotopic through taut foliations. So, OK. So a foliation without torus leaves is taut automatically. Maybe I should say that. So, OK. What else did I want to say? So I wanted to go through some examples which illustrate these conditions. And then I wanted to present a C0 example, which, and maybe kind of speculate a little bit what the analogous theorem should be if I write a zero here. So, okay, so the simplest example where non-uniqueness shows up, and maybe you should, if you'd like to see an example of a foliation being approximated by a context structure, here it is. So the manifold I will be looking at is T3, and the foliation, so I view this as a quotient of R3 mod this lattice, and I write my foliation as the kernel of dz, so the coordinates here are x, y, z. And okay, so if I want to approximate this foliation by a context structure, it is sufficient to approximate this one form by a contact form. So here's a contact form, which I denote by alpha, epsilon, and k. So it will come with two parameters, epsilon, k. So epsilon is a non-zero real number, and k is a positive integer. So let me write down this form. So this is a positive contact form, you can check. So maybe. And so what does this say? So as epsilon goes to zero, this form goes, so converges against this form. So indeed, this is a deformation of a foliation into a context structure. So for positive epsilons, this defines a context structure, and for epsilon equals zero, this is this foliation. So that's what I call deformation. So how does this depend on epsilon? Well, this context structure, of course, it does depend on epsilon, but Gray's theorem tells you that if you vary epsilon, as long as it stays non-zero, you get isotopic context structures. And you are allowed, so epsilon may be infinity, so there is only one context structure. So you may think of epsilon as being not there. So in contrast to this k, so the kernel of alpha epsilon k has a Giroux torsion k minus 1. Oh, this is not a sine h, this is a cosine. I'm sorry. So, okay. So these context structures are different, and they are kind of badly different. They are not even diffeomorphic. So they have different Giroux torsion. This was kind of one of the torsions that Andy did not talk about very much yesterday. So he talked about other torsions. So, okay. So this shows, first of all, that okay, there are cases where torus leaves prevent you from having uniqueness. And also, if you kind of work a little bit, then you can do the same, basically the same phenomenon shows up whenever you have a torus leaf. So, Okay, so if you have a torus leaf, then indeed there are many contact structures approximating your foliation. Okay, so that was one example. I want to say something more about contact structures on T3 because this will relate to the next example. So, okay, so let's look at the two torus at some level Z. So this is one of my initial leaves, but this is more a coincidence. So this, I don't insist that this is a leaf, but so if you look at the tangent bundle of this thing and you intersect this tangent bundle with xi, so I try to do this more traditional notation here. So this is a xi. So I should write xi epsilon k, but then it gets kind of terrible, okay? So what do you get? You get a foliation by lines in this case. So this is the characteristic foliation on this T2 times Z, on this two torus. And in this case, it's a foliation by parallel lines. And depending on whether Z is rational or not, these leaves that you get are all closed or all lines. So these tori with a characteristic foliation like this, these are called a pre-Lagrangian tori. And so now I could have taken another torus. And the claim is, if I would have not taken a torus which is isotopic to this one, then I would never see a picture like this. Okay, so a contact structure singles out an isotopic class of tori. These contain pre-Lagrangian tori. Okay. Excuse me? Of course, yes. And I also maybe, so I'm not, so this is due to Kanda and Giroux, and other people proved it too. And, okay, so the next example is at the same time an example of this type, and also an example where you see that this deformation is not always possible, okay? So it's more complicated, so my presentation will be more sketchy. Its characteristic foliation is, it can be defined by a closed form.
So you're saying there's only one slice?
Up to isotopy, yeah. I mean, you can, there are many contact homomorphisms, you can push it around using contact homomorphisms, but there's not only one isotopic class. And it's called pre-Lagrangian because kind of if you have a contact structure, then you can consider its symplectization and it becomes a Lagrangian torus. Okay, fine. So the next example is not surprisingly again on the torus. But now I change my foliation and I take something just as simple maybe, but will be more interesting. And so I want a foliation by planes. So I require that A, B, and C are linearly independent over Q. Okay, fine. So then I have a foliation by planes. It's a linear foliation. Very simple. So according to this theorem, there is, in every C0 neighborhood of this foliation, there is a contact structure. So what I want, I will not prove it, but I will say something how you would prove it. So the statement is this. So given, so that's a fact, okay? I state this as a fact. So given xi, a contact structure on T3, there is a C0 neighborhood of TF, which does not contain a contact structure which is isotopic to xi. OK, Okay, so maybe I draw some cartoon of the situation. So here's TF. And every neighborhood of this red dot contains a context structure. It's just that no connected component of the space of context structures has this thing in its closure. So it kind of, maybe I draw something like this. So this is Xi, and maybe there's another context structure which is green. It gets closer, it's Xi prime, and many of them. Okay, but none of them converges to, gets quite here. So this implies, so this fact is, a corollary of this fact is that this foliation cannot be deformed into a context structure, right? Because this context structure would be exactly one which would accumulate in this dot, and I just said there's no such thing. Okay, so I want to outline the method or the tool which is used to prove such a statement, because this is kind of a recurrent theme in this kind of whole business. So, okay, so maybe how does one approach this type of problem? So what I want to do is you do one thing, fix a foliation G, which is transverse to F. And I want this to be a foliation by tori, okay? So later we will do more complicated things, but okay. So I will just assume that, okay, so what do I see on a leaf of G when I intersect it with the leaves of F? Well, not surprisingly, I see a linear foliation as before. Okay, so, and because my foliation F is a foliation by planes, this is going to be a foliation by lines. So this is a leaf of G, and intersecting TF. Okay. So now if I approximate F, if I pick a context structure which is close to F, then it will also be transverse to this leaf. So let's see what we see. So here's what we see. So generically, okay, so typically, so if Xi is close to F, then typically you see a characteristic foliation as I will try to draw it. So okay, so I made no attempt to make these things very close to each other. And well, maybe I should have used red here. Okay, so this is again the tangent space of the leaf of G, but this time I intersect it with Xi. So what do I see? I see something of more Smale type, and there are some closed orbits, and they kind of alternate, so some of them are repelling, and some of them are attracting. So now, what I want to say is, okay, I want to know something about my context structure. And there are two things I want to know if I want to identify the context structure. So I want to identify the torsion, and I want to identify where is this pre-Lagrangian torus. And what I'm trying to do is trying to explain how do you find this pre-Lagrangian torus. And so the pre-Lagrangian torus yes, so, okay. So every context structure is oriented, every surface is oriented, and this induces orient. There is some rule which tells you how to orient this intersection. Okay, fine. So now if you, so now you vary this torus. Okay, now I looked at one leaf and I said typically you see this, but now I kind of look at the entire foliation and the intersection of Xi with all the leaves. And so again, typically, so following Giroux again, one can show that the union of these closed leaves of T, okay, so the union of these closed leaves will be a union of tori. And now let's think of how does the characteristic foliation on these tori look. Well, I just presented to you that it's a union of closed Legendrian curves. So the characteristic foliations on these tori will be a foliation all of whose leaves are closed. So this is a pre-Lagrangian torus. And so it is, because it's determined uniquely up to isotopy, this is the pre-Lagrangian torus. So either connected component of these. So let me just write, found a pre-Lagrangian torus for Xi. So now I will not carry this out, but the way you found it allows you to compare the distance between the slope of the leaves of the foliation you started with, this irrational foliation, and the slope of the torus. So every torus is isotopic to a linear torus, and this is what I mean, okay? So you have an angle between these two, and what you can show is that the distance between Xi and F is bounded from below by the angle between these the torus that you found, the pre-Lagrangian torus, and some, I don't know, this plane. And because this is an irrational plane and this is a linear torus, this distance is positive. So there is no, so this kind of proves this statement here. Okay, so just to have language for the future, so surfaces obtained in this way are sheets, are called sheets. And in French, because it's, I think I translated this, so maybe it's wrong, so it's feuille in Giroux's papers. Okay, fine. So these objects will turn up later. So this is just a simple application of this technique. So, okay, so these were two examples where non-unique shows up. I want to discuss a third example. This will be C0. So before I do that, I want to discuss a little bit how the C2 hypothesis, why does it show up, how does it show up? Okay, so maybe I erase these things here. I don't know if, so, okay, maybe I should write like this. So how does C2 enter the discussion? Well, so I will try to prove something or give ideas of how to prove something, and but not now, okay? I wanted to save this for the end. So I wanted these examples in my block. So, but how does the C2 hypothesis enter? So you, to prove either of these theorems, you look at minimal sets, okay? So minimal sets of F. So what are these? So these are closed sets, closed subsets of M. They are unions of leaves. They are not empty, and they are minimal with these properties. Okay, so this is the definition of a minimal set. So the good thing on compact manifolds, minimal sets exist, and on non-compact manifolds, on open manifolds, minimal sets do not necessarily exist, which is kind of the source of why you want to close here. So what type of minimal sets do exist? So there are closed leaves. Okay, fine, so that's clearly minimal. Then it may happen that there is only one minimal set, and this is M. So this is the case, for example, in this example here. Every leaf is dense. Okay? So this may happen. And then if you are not in these two cases, you are called exceptional. Okay, so this makes more sense than the way I presented it. So if you take your minimal set and take a point in it and take a short arc which is transverse to the foliation and then intersect this short arc with the leaves contained in your minimal set. So what you see here is a discrete set. So maybe you take a transversal which is so short that it cuts your closed leaf only once. So this is what you see. So here's your transversal and you hit every leaf of the minimal set. And then the only case which can occur, and this is a small lemma or something, is a Cantor set. Okay, so a closed perfect set. Okay, so this is a Cantor set. Okay. So we can imagine these. Okay, these are complicated, but these look like they would be difficult. But in the C2 world, they come with some nice property. And the property is given by Sackstede's theorem. So Sackstede's theorem says the following. So for C2 foliations, an exceptional minimal set contains a curve gamma with a non-trivial linear holonomy. So let me explain what that means. Okay, so this says there is some curve gamma with some property. So gamma is tangent to a leaf. So here, this is supposed to be gamma. And I want to so this is a closed curve. So this point is this point. It's tangent to a leaf. And I pick a small annulus, which is transverse to F. And I look at the characteristic foliation of F, so at the imprint of F on this little annulus. And what I see in this under these assumptions is something like this. So, okay, so I orient it such that it's attractive and it's just as simple as it could be. Okay, so it will become later why this is useful for these theorems, but now I want to use this statement to distinguish kind of C0 foliations. So more precisely, a foliation can be C0, and if I say it's not a C2 foliation, I mean it's not homeomorphic to a C2 foliation. So I need some criterion to distinguish these. So this is what I will use. So now there will be a more complicated example, which will be C0. So I have to construct a C0 foliation. So, okay, so I should attribute this example. This is basically Jonathan's example, who said, I think yesterday, that this uniqueness theorem is unlikely to hold in the C0 world. And this is the example which shows why he said this. So, okay.
So there you're using just contracting, or you're using the derivative is less than one?
Well, in the C0 world, I have this.
For the C2.
For the C2 world, I have this. But as a matter of fact, all I'm using is that it's attractive in either case. So I construct. So now I want to construct a C0 foliation, which is taut and nice and everything you would imagine, but it's not homeomorphic to a C2 foliation, and it will fail to have this property which I just erased, that kind of context structures will be uniquely determined by this foliation. So probably, so this is not a well worked out example, but so maybe you can make up your opinion about this example. So what I start with is you take a surface sigma, and I want it to be hyperbolic. So on L, I pick a lamination, geodesic lamination. So think of a geodesic lamination as it's a partial foliation, which is a foliation by complete geodesics. Okay, so you don't stop somewhere, and it's kind of the geodesics are nicely organized like this. They don't intersect or do anything bad like this. So it's a geodesic lamination. It does not contain a closed geodesic. So if you were ever, would try to define a notion of holonomy for laminations, this would be a lamination with no holonomy because there are no closed curves. Or no, yeah. So now the manifold I want to look at will be a three manifold. So this will be sigma cross S1. It comes with its projection to sigma. And I look at pi 1, the pre-image of this lamination. So this is a lamination by cylinders. And it extends to a C0 foliation F. So I should have made one more assumption, so I apologize. So you have a collection of geodesics in your manifold, and you can look at the complement. And the complement consists of regions, and these regions are bounded by infinitely long geodesics. So, and I want to say that each of these regions is bounded by an even number of such geodesics, okay? So, I don't know. M minus L consists of even-sided polygons. I don't know if this is English, but maybe it's comprehensible. Okay, so this is what I want to say. So I have fixed some leaves, and I have to tell you what are the other leaves. So of course, I won't do this precisely, but I drew a picture of how you do it. And the picture is here. So you should, so what I should have drawn is, so this is how to fill a foregon, okay, something like this. Okay, and what I'm telling you is how to fill it kind of above some compact central piece. And then, so this line here is supposed to lie above this line, and this line lies above this one, and so on. And you can imagine how to extend this further. So this here, just to be sure, is a leaf, is a piece of a leaf of your lamination, okay? So there are, in this picture, there are four special leaves, look like this. And the other leaves, all of them look like this, and the orange stuff is the orange stuff over here, and this blue piece is this blue piece, and this blue piece is somewhere hidden here. Okay, so this is how you do it. So now, this foliation is not homeomorphic to a C2 foliation. Why not? Well, this is a foliation or a laminate, so every leaf accumulates on a leaf in here by construction. So therefore, my every minimal set is contained in this lamination. Okay, and on the and this thing has no holonomy. So if you are an exceptional minimal set and you have holonomy, then So you have attractive holonomy, and this is part of your minimal set. But as I explained, this minimal set, it intersects every closed transversal nearby. So this is not the only leaf that I see. Okay? So there are pieces of my, if I want this to be homomorphic to a C2 foliation, I would have to have kind of some leaves of L which would accumulate on another leaf of L like this, or maybe the same, I don't know. So this is not a C2 lamination, C2 foliation. And so what's the trouble? And this is the part which is not well checked, of course. So now you want to think how to, you want to understand context structures which could approximate this, this foliation. So this foliation is taught. So by this Kazes-Roberts-Bowden extension of Eliasberg's Thurston theorem, you can approximate it by context structures. And so there is this fact, which I think is the why is this interesting? So taught foliations give rise to weakly fillable and in particular taught context structures. And this is true regardless of C0, C1, and there's no problem with that. So every foliation that I get by approximating my foliation here will be a tight context structure. And actually will be a universally tight context structure. And Giroux and other people classified classified tight context structures on on S1 bundles over surfaces. And this classification, so there are context structures in many flavors, and these context structures that you get here are of one flavor, which is classified. So maybe I should write something. The context structures which are C0 close to F are most of the time, so I should have kind of, so there are two, so I could implant this in two ways, okay? So this piece, I could have also turned it around. And so what I want to make sure is that I have regions where my foliation is positively transverse to the fibers and some regions where it's negatively transverse to the fibers. So I do that, okay? So which are C0 close to F are classified in terms of closed, simple closed curves or more precisely unions of simple closed curves on the surface. And it's just kind of so these curves should approximate the lamination, but there are many curves or kind of it is, in my opinion, inconceivable that this lamination would be approximated kind of by one collection of closed curve, right? So what will happen is a phenomenon similar to what happened in this irrational foliation on the three torus. So you have context structures which approximate your foliation, but you just, none of these gets very close to your foliation. Okay, so what's the problem? So the problem is, of course, this lamination. So this lamination, L, so this contains the minimal set. And so this contains minimal sets, the minimal set is a union of cylinders without holonomy. So in the C2 world, such a minimal set is the entire manifold. In the C0 world, it's just not. So if you want a speculation of how this uniqueness theorem should sound in the C0 world, you should certainly exclude these kind of sets, and you should exclude the analogous sets where you have planes here. But yeah, but this is a speculation. So yes. So here I'm looking, so you should think of a fiber here. This is a fiber.
No, no, I know. Like, but this piece that you have, this 8 gun times S1, on each transverse boundary, you have the same polynomial. How do you match them with the foliation, a delamination, the partial lamination that you have? They have like arbitrary polynomial, right?
They have no polynomial. Well, they have, there is some pseudo holonomy pseudo group, but there is what I explained before was this germinal holonomy, and they have none of that. But so I admit that I don't understand your question, so I cannot answer it really. So maybe just to make what I didn't say is that this is supposed to be the fiber, and this is supposed to be the kind of sitter buffer fiber, and you should take this piece, plug it in here. And then you kind of have these things which are almost vertical, and you kind of fill these
right,
in
yeah,
here.
Yeah, that almost vertical, how does it match the partial lamination that you have?
It matches only continuously. It matches badly.
It's just that the picture you drew looks as though there's something with boundary, just going to be glued up to something else.
Oh, that's well, here, okay, so I, okay, so you can extend this piece and. And so I didn't want to draw this thing because then the picture gets more cluttered. So. This is kind of an auxiliary line, okay? So you shouldn't.
So
you should think of this as some ideal thing, and it continues until infinity. Okay, I'm sorry. Okay, fine. So this is what I wanted to say about C0 and or this kind of speculation in this example. So I have 15 minutes. So in 15 minutes, I will try to explain why Eliasberg's and Thurston's theorem is true, and why, and give some idea how the proof of this uniqueness theorem works. Okay. Okay. So. So I don't know if this is, so according to me, this is the main idea of this Eliasberg-Thurston thing, okay? I agree that this is subjective. So what I will assume is that I find something like this, okay? I will start with a curve which has attractive holonomy, and I will try to explain how to make approximate my foliation by something which is contact near this curve without changing it very much elsewhere and keeping it foliated elsewhere in particular. So here's what I do. I draw this picture again, but bigger. So this is my annulus, and it contains this curve with attractive holonomy. Okay, fine. So this is the back part of the following box. So this is a cylinder, not really a box, but I draw it as a box. So these sides here are identified. And I divide my box into two pieces. And so this thing, maybe for the time being, is the back. So now, outside of this box, so in the middle here, there is a leaf. So this picture will get too cluttered if I draw everything I say. But you should think of in the middle, there is kind of some flat surface, and then there are kind of strips accumulating on it. Okay, so just this picture times an interval. This is what you see. So now, okay, I keep my plane field outside of this thing unchanged. Outside of this kind of cylinder, it is unchanged. I remove everything which is inside the back box. I keep everything which is inside the front box, but I change it. So I take whatever I saw here, and I kind of at the boundary, at the front boundary, I change nothing, and then I start pushing things downwards. Okay, so what you see if you kind of would look at this, I don't know, square piece, is before the characteristic foliation looked like this. And now the characteristic foliation looks like this. Okay, so this coincides with the original foliation at the boundary. So what is the success of this? So let's look what happened to the characteristic foliation on the back, and let's compare it with what is here. So how do I identify these two sides? Well, I assume that there is a family of Legendrian curves which kind of identify the front and the back. So okay, so Legendrian is usually used in the world of contact structures, but I usually use it for every plane field, okay? So if you are tangent to a plane field, you are Legendrian. So I keep this Legendrian foliation, and I forget, the future new confoliation is the technical term, this will still be Legendrian for the new confoliation. And what I have to kind of tell you, what I want to construct, is the complementary part of this line. So what do I see? Well, I pushed this thing down. So here's what I see. So this is what happened to this leaf. And now I continue and I do things like this. So, so now the big success of this picture is the following. So if you look at it at each point, you can look at the green line, which is in the back, and the green line, which is in the front. And the green line is always below the front line, white line, okay, everywhere. Here, I don't know, here, and of course at the boundary they coincide. Okay. So how do I fill in this hole with a confoliation? Well, if I want to interpolate between this characteristic foliation, the white one, and the green one, I have to rotate. And along everywhere I rotate in the same sense. So this allows me to fill this in by a confoliation. Okay, fine, so I did this near a curve with this type of holonomy. So now there's a notion of being sometimes attractive and kind of generalizing this. The proof idea remains the same. And the sport then is to find enough curves with sometimes attractive holonomy. So I mentioned before, and this example of an irrational foliation on the torus shows that there are foliations which have absolutely no holonomy except the identity. So that's not very attractive. So what you do in this case, and this is maybe the hardest part of this theorem, you have to approximate your foliation by another one which has attractive holonomy, and then you approximate that. So, and by the way, so this Eliasberg theorem, Eliasberg-Thurston theorem, says that C2 foliations can be approximated in a C0 sense. So I believe that it's possible to prove this theorem for C2 being approximated by C2 close contact structures unless you start with a foliation without holonomy. So that sounds extremely painful, and so maybe it's not true then. But again, I don't know. So okay, fine. So I told you how to create contactness or non-integrability in these little regions. And if you've done that a finite times, so you have to kind of organize your minimal sets. So every leaf accumulates on a minimal set. So if you do this for all minimal sets, they hit a region like this, then every point is connected by a Legendrian curve to a point where you have this non-integrability property. And it's easy to propagate non-integrability, relatively easy. So in the C0 world, it's a pain, but in the C2 world, it's nice. And yes, yes, you can do it by some heat flow argument. So for, I'm presenting this also because it's kind of, the structure of this uniqueness theorem is similar but inverse. So in there, it kind of, you would have to flow backwards, and there PDEs will not work. So, okay, fine. So this is the main idea, and so you have to distribute the contactness all over the world, all over your manifold. And it's clear that kind of having this property helps, yeah? So this tells you the worst minimal sets have linear holonomy, and you kind of don't have to talk with them. Or they talk to you very nicely. So now the uniqueness theorem, 7 minutes. So of course, I will not tell you everything. So I will focus on a particular situation. So I will focus on the case where you have one minimal set and it's a closed leaf of positive genus. And so here's a cartoon. So I want to kind of inverse this strategy. So what I do is I start with two context structures. So maybe I should write something. So F, a foliation on M, exactly one minimal set. And this minimal set is a closed leaf, and it's hyperbolic. Okay. So I choose, so I hide some details, okay, but I cleverly choose a neighborhood of my leaf. This will be this big box. And then there is the world outside of this big box. So here's my leaf. And what I also choose is a line field L. Which is transverse to F, and every context structure I will consider explicitly by saying it will be transverse to this line field. So in the details of this construction, there are context structures which are not transverse to this line field. Okay, so this isotopy which connects the two context structures which are close to your foliation in this uniqueness theorem, this is a big isotopy. It does this. It does not stay somewhere in a controlled fashion. Okay, so. So step one is, so I start with two foliations. They are called Xi0 and Xi2. And I isotop, so this is a cartoon of a proof, okay? So I isotop Xi0 to a context structure Xi1, which coincides with Xi2 outside of a neighborhood of sigma. And the neighborhood where they do not coincide is this. So outside here, Xi1 is Xi0, Xi2, and here Xi is Xi2. Okay, so this requires some work, but I hide it. And now what you want to say is, okay, I want to apply some classification result from contact topology and say, okay, so I have two contact structures, they have kind of come along with nice properties. Maybe there is up to isotopy, a unique context structure with these properties on this kind of manifold sigma cross interval. So here's the best classification and the only maybe classification result for context structures on surface times interval where the surface is not a torus. So this is a long theorem, so I should have erased that. But anyways, so this is a classification result of a Honda Cazes and Martich. So it's quite an incredible, it's really not easy. So, okay, so let me, what do I fix? So I consider context structures on surface cross interval, and I fix a germ of context structures psi boundary near the boundary. Okay, and I want many things of this. And so I didn't define this word, but and I won't. But it's a generic property, so such that, okay. So the characteristic foliation on the boundary is convex, and the dividing set, so for both boundary components, the dividing set consists of, is 2 times gamma I, so it's it, So whatever the dividing set is, it's a collection of curves. And I require this is what I consider is the case when there are two closed curves which are parallel. Okay, so that's it's never empty and it has kind of all kinds of properties. So this is as simple as it can get if I add the hypothesis that where gamma I is non-separating. Okay, so what does this imply? So this has, so I want that this germ is, this germ is automatically tight. And I don't want to discuss kind of what this implies or kind of what this really says, but what I want to say is the result of the classification. So the result of the classification is if gamma zero, so zero and one refer to this zero and one, is not isotopic to gamma one, then there are four extensions of psi boundary to of the germ to the interior. Okay, and if by chance gamma zero is isotopic to gamma one, the same statement is true but with a five. So that's interesting. So up to finite choices, I'm actually already done. So I know in advance. So what I know is, I never assumed that the context structures are tight, but because they are transverse to this line field, this is what I say now is not strictly true. But kind of foliation context structures which are transverse to line fields tend to be tight. Okay, and here the assumptions imply that yes, they are tight. So indeed, up to finite ambiguity, I'm done. So I want to figure out which one. And also, I'm not done up to finite ambiguity because I have to achieve these assumptions, right? So if I draw a torus here, I draw this, or not torus, this surface here, there's no reason why this should be true. Okay, so this is a geometric assumption. So this has topological implications. And the topological implication is that the Euler class of Xi evaluated on the surface is 2g minus 2, where g is the genus. So this is as big as it can get by the Thurston-Willikin inequality. And it has some implications on the shape of dividing set. And what it means is that this dividing set will be more general, but it will consist of pairs of curves which bound annually. Okay? So and I have to get rid of these annually except one. And I have to get rid of all separating annually. So, and here we come back to the story with these. So I'm over time. That's kind of, I will take 2 minutes, okay? So I do something similar to this. And the foliation and the surfaces I take are this product decomposition. So I look at all these surfaces and I pick one closed, so one annulus, these annuli contain attractive closed leaves. So again, I would have to explain many words. But these attractive closed leaves, I want to get rid of them, all of them except one. So, and here's what I do. Well, I kind of look at this foliation, and I want to get rid of this. So maybe I should look at kind of what happens on nearby leaves. And here's what happens. Okay, so what I want to avoid is that this thing, so what I want to see is something like this, okay? Because then I can replace this surface by a surface like this. And if you do your computation carefully, then you will see that this makes this closed orbit go away. And if you are even more careful and have some other closed orbit elsewhere, you don't create new ones. Okay? So this is how, in principle, how to get things. But the point of why am I explaining this and not something else is the following. So I want to avoid that this leaves this neighborhood where I don't understand anything. Yeah? So, okay. So I haven't used yet, I used implicitly plenty of times, but here's a point where I use it crucially, that Xi is not so far away from the foliation. So how is Xi related to this pre-Lagrangian torus? So it looks like this. So it's steeper along the P, so it's steeper than this pre-Lagrangian annulus, if you like, in the places where this annulus consists of attractive closed curves, okay? So this annulus If it's very steep, then the contact structure has to be even steeper. And I can make, and I have not told you the kind of, I don't know, 42 assumptions I need to make on the neighborhood. But this, you can make your assumption such that this thing never leaves your kind of neighborhood, your prefix neighborhood. And so you have to carry this out kind of, I don't know how many times. But in the end, yes, you manage to get rid of all closed leaves except one. So you satisfy this hypothesis. And once you've done that, you also learned which of these extensions you have. Okay, so this does two things at once. And I won't explain this because I'll stop.